Hello everyone, welcome back to the channel. Let's get on to PIBs from 25th of January till 31st of January 2020. Alright, but before jumping into the articles, there's just one clarification that while explaining yesterday's PIB, I just kept on saying that GSAT is a communication satellite and not a navigation satellite. Basically, it was an error on my part. Aisa bolte bolte bolna tha ki it is not a remote sensing satellite, but I just ended up saying it's not a navigation satellite. So yeah, this is it. So broad idea would suffice here. Abko koi PhD nahi karni hai, right? So GSAT is basically a communication satellite because broadly we have two types of satellites. Number one, geostationary, and number second, polar. So as the name suggests, GSAT, geostationary, geosynchronous or geostationary, whatever way you want to call it. So basically it's a communication satellite and it is not a remote sensing satellite because polar satellites are the remote sensing satellites for various reasons. Most important being they cover Earth in the day itself. They move from north to south and we need a satellites which can cover entire Earth in a day itself because its purpose is to look for the resources in the Earth, go for remote sensing. So this is the very reason GSAT is a basically communication satellite and not a remote sensing satellite, but other satellites, polar satellites, they are remote sensing. So bus, I just would like to clarify this thing because it's a really, really a big mistake to categorize GSAT as not a navigation. So this is it. So abhi clarify ho gaya, GSAT is a communication satellite but not a remote sensing satellite. That's it. Alright, so now we'll be moving on to 25th of January dated PIB. So this is about the National Voters Day to be celebrated on 25th of January 2020. Nothing very important, it's just that the theme is something that can be asked. So theme is electoral literacy for stronger democracy. Nothing to be understood, please memorize. Theme for National Voters Day 2020 is electoral literacy for stronger democracy. That's it. Further, this is important. 10 more wetlands from India get the Ramsar site tag. All right. So almost every year we come across one question in the UPSC prelims exam with regard to Ramsar. So it's a very, very important. Please read this thing in your book, the book Shankar environment book, that it has covered this thing holistically, but here current affair parts we will be covering. So Maharashtra gets its first, Punjab adds 3, and UP 6 to the wetland list. What exactly is the Ramsar Convention? So this is one of the oldest intergovernmental accord. So herein governments are involved. It's not like non-government organization or parties other than governments are involved. No, it's a government to government accord. So intergovernmental accord signed by member countries to preserve the ecological characters of their wetland of international importance. Please memorize this thing. International importance is our key word here because otherwise there are a lot of wetlands in a country, right? But not everybody, every wetland would be getting a tag or getting a Ramsar tag or getting a place into this prestigious list because only those wetlands which are internationally important. For example, we have Sundarbans. Now the ecology of Sundarbans is something that would impact not just India but even Bhutan, Bangladesh, Nepal and neighboring countries, Myanmar, every lot more than not just India but many more nations, right? So the wetland has to be of international importance in order to get them this very Ramsar tag. So when was it signed? It was signed in the year 1971 in an Iranian city of Ramsar, and this is why we call it Ramsar Convention. Alright, all these points are important. 1971, Ramsar, a place in Iran, it's intergovernmental accord to preserve the ecological characters of wetland of international importance. Further, the aim of the Ramsar list is to develop and maintain an international network of wetlands which are important for the conservation of global biological diversity and for sustaining human life through the maintenance of their ecosystem components. Quite obvious, either way this is something that is there. Nothing to be understood here again. Wetlands declared as Ramsar sites are protected under strict guidelines of the convention. This is very, very important. So they are protected under strict guidelines that are released by the Ramsar Convention. Further, with the addition of these 3 + 6 + 1, right now India is having 37 protected sites under Ramsar. So with this, number of Ramsar sites in India are now 37, and the entire surface that is covered by these areas is this, over 1 lakh hectare. Maharashtra gets its first Ramsar site and the name is Nandur Madhmeshwar. Please keep this thing in your mind. It's something to be memorized. Nandur Madhmeshwar, it's from Maharashtra. Punjab, which already has 3 Ramsar sites, it has got 3 more. Keshwapur Miani, number 1. Second is Bias Conservation Reserve and the last one is Nangal. Keshwapur Miani, Bias Conservation Reserve and the Nangal. And UP with 1 Ramsar site has added 6 more. So UP will be having 7 now, and Punjab will be having 3 plus 3, 6, and Maharashtra will be having 1. So addition to the UPs are Nawabganj, Parvati, Agra, Saman, Samaspur, Sandhi and Sarsai Nawar. So this is it, how it is. Nawabganj, Parvati, Agra, Saman, Samaspur, Sandhi and Sarsai Nawar. So all these are the names. These are important. Please memorize these things even if they seem difficult. Further, wetland provides a wide range of important resources and ecosystem services such as food, water, fiber, groundwater recharge, water purification, flood moderation, erosion control and climate regulation. Because we have one question in mains which talked about the wetlands per se. So all these were the points that we should have written, because these are the key words. These are not just the redundant point. Every point is a complete statement in itself. They provide food, water, fiber, groundwater recharge, water purification, flood moderation, erosion control and climate regulation. So climate regulation is a very good word. It's under its domain there are a lot of things. So one word is encapsulating the essence of a lot of things. They are in fact are a major source of water, and our main supply of fresh water comes from an area of wetlands which helps soak rainfall and recharge groundwater. That's it. Further, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has prepared it for 4-pronged strategy for the restoration of wetlands. So government is not very ambivalent or oblivious to the threats to the wetlands. Even government is quite aware of what exactly is happening to the wetlands. This is the very reason government also has come up with the 4-pronged strategy, which includes what? Number 1, preparing a baseline data. Preparation of data is the first step towards conserving anything, be it wetland, be it your canal, be it your rivers, or be it anything. Then wetland health cards, enlisting wetland mitras, that itself implies that people's cooperation would be something that government would be seeking here. And preparing a targeted integrated management plan. So look at the keyword here, look at the language here. It's not just mere preparation of plans, but rather preparation of a targeted plan. And more precisely, targeted integrated management plans. This is something that we can write in our answer. Instead of merely writing making plans, go for writing making targeted integrated management plans. So definitely this is with regard to fulfilling PM's dream of Nal Se Jal in each household. So main specific information is there that depends upon how we can incorporate these good languages in our answer. But again, plain specific information is definitely there, which is there to be memorized only. That's it. Further, this is with regard to President of India visiting Haryana to inaugurate the 34th Surajkund International Crafts Mela. So where was Surajkund International Crafts Mela held in Haryana? What edition it was? 34th. Nothing very important here, but good not to skip. Because UPSC even asked us the national aquatic animal of India, and which we sometimes feel is not important, but even sometimes these tiny information turn out to be important, so it's good not to leave anything, right? So either way, now this is important. India achieves complete phase out of one of the most potent ozone depleting chemical. So what is it? It's a hydrofluorofluorocarbon 141b. So this has been phased out by India, which is a ozone depleting chemical. Basically, India is not having any production base of this particular chemical here. So effectively, what government of India has done is put a ban onto the import of this very chemical. And either way, if there is no production base in India and there is an import ban, that simply means that India has phased out the usage of this very ozone depleting chemical. So that's it. The name itself is important, but it's not difficult. Chloro word is there, so chloro means it's ozone depleting because chlorine acts as a catalyst for the ozone depletion. Further, this is about the Sampriti 9. What exactly is Sampriti 9? It's a joint military exercise between India and Bangladesh. Alright, so nothing important here, but it's good not to leave it out. India-Bangladesh joint military exercise Sampriti and the 9th edition. Further, this is important. Indian Navy launches Operation Vanilla to provide humanitarian assistance and disaster relief at Madagascar. Alright, so Operation Vanilla is what? It is not a military operation, rather it's a operation by the Indian Navy to provide the disaster relief at Madagascar. And why are we providing the disaster relief? Because this very country was hit by Cyclone Diane. Cyclone Diane hit Madagascar, and Operation Vanilla is by the Indian Navy to provide the humanitarian assistance and disaster relief to this very country, and that's it. Madagascar is a part of the Vanilla Islands. There are like 4 or 5 tiny islands together, which we call as Vanilla Islands. Maybe this could be the reason why Navy has given this very operation as the name Operation Vanilla, but that's it. Further, this is about the first waste to energy plant in Bhubaneswar by Indian Railways. So this is good, because this is not a conventional waste to energy plant. This is using a new sort of technology, poly crack. But let's just proceed as per PIB now. All type of waste, including plastic and e-waste, can be converted to light diesel. So all type of waste is our keyword here. It means everything. Even if PIB had not mentioned explicitly plastic or e-waste, otherwise then also all types becomes important, because it means everything, right? So all types are keyword. It could be anything, but let's just go through the waste now. So it could be like plastic, petroleum sludge, unsegregated municipal solid waste. Look at the keyword here, unsegregated. It's not like in a conventional manner people or the municipal corporation has to segregate the waste, solid waste and the plastic waste and the e-waste. No, this is quite good. Unsegregated municipal solid waste with moisture up to 50% can be used in this very waste to energy conversion plant. E-waste, automobile fluff, organic waste including bamboo, garden waste, etc. So organic waste, either way obvious, and jatropha fruit and palm birch. But look at other things. So plastic, petroleum sludge, unsegregated municipal solid waste and e-waste, these are all something that can be used in this very waste to energy plant. And now let's have a look at the technology, poly crack. So poly crack is a patented technology, is the first of its kind in Indian Railways and fourth in India. So what exactly is this? So it converts the multiple feedstocks into hydrocarbon, liquid fuels, gas, carbon and water. So multiple feedstock it can take and convert them into various fuels, gas, carbon and water. It's a closed loop system, and so it does not emit any hazardous pollutant into the atmosphere. So in incineration, we know a lot of hazardous pollutants get released into the atmosphere, but because the poly crack is a closed system, so it does not emit any hazardous pollutants. Further, the combustible non-condensed gases, they are reused for providing energy to the entire system. So all these hydrocarbon, liquid fuels, the gas, the carbon, water that is to be released, that are to be further used to do a lot of things, for example to light the furnaces. So this is it. Further, this PIB is talking about the advantages of the poly crack over the conventional approach for treating the solid waste. So let's just go through them now, because a 10 marker can be asked. First of all, pre-segregation of waste is not required to reform the waste. Very, very important. At every place, we just have to write, no matter what, that go for segregation of waste. But this is the technology where this burden of segregation would be removed. So no need to segregate the waste. The unsegregated waste can also be taken by this very treatment, waste treatment plant. So waste as collected can be directly fed into the poly crack. Further, it has high tolerance to moisture, hence drying of waste is not required. So it can tolerate moisture up to 50%, as we have read here. Further, waste is processed and reformed within 24 hours. So it's quite a quick process. Further, it's an enclosed unit, hence the working environment is dust-free. Excellent air quality surrounding the plant, very, very important. I mean, this is the reason people sometimes don't want any waste to energy conversion plant or any garbage disposal plant in their vicinity. If I am to cite an example, in our area also, there was a door-to-door signature campaign by the Panch and Sarpanch. They were asking people to sign on a document. They were about to submit that to the district commissioner, wherein it was stated that we don't want any waste conversion plant in our vicinity. It's going to have come right at our neighborhood. Like when they came at our home, then I was like, we should be allowing the district administration to have this waste to energy conversion plant, because we want the garbage to be removed from our vicinity and we just have to have a waste to energy conversion plant, right? And if you don't let the government go for it, then how can garbage be removed? But then the person in charge, he explained the entire thing to me, that it wasn't just about the plant per se. The way the plant was coming up, it would have added a lot of dirty water into the ground. It would have added a lot of smell and air pollution and leaching and groundwater pollution, and the treatment facility was not in a very modernized system the way we otherwise perceive it to be, the way we otherwise want it to be. In our imagination, we think of it as being a very modern sort of system, but it actually was not. So that was the very reason. So maybe this is really, really good alternative. If this polycrack technology is adopted by all the municipal waste or any waste disposal plants, waste to energy conversion plants, then it would be really good. It would lessen the resistance of the people towards these disposable plants. So this was just a deviation, but I think it's really important that people are open, people are receptive to this very idea. The participation, the willing participation of people is something that is needed, and this is the technology that would aid us in this very regard. So yeah. Further, biological decomposition is not allowed as the waste is treated as it is received. So like if waste is to be dumped somewhere and it's gonna take some 15 days in order it to be treated, then within 15 days there going to be some sort of decomposition, right? But here this thing won't happen because waste would be treated immediately as and when they get received. Further, the footprint of the plant is small, hence the area required for installing the plant is less when compared with conventional method of processing. Very, very important and indeed very good, because on a practical level, at the ground level, this is the problem that the people have to come across. Land has to be acquired, and this is the most difficult part of any government program. People don't want to give up their agricultural land or any land, so because its area would be small, so we really don't need to go for a lot of land acquisition. So this is really good. All constituents are converted into valuable energy, thereby making it zero discharge process. So anything that gets released, it would be somehow be used up in order to do something else, in order to do something more productive, so nothing gets wasted. So you can read other points as well, but I feel these would suffice. Even if it's a 10 market question, we really can't memorize everything, right? So also there is no probability that it would be asked. Further, this is about the Togo. Basically, the NTPC has signed a letter of engagement with the country Togo in order to aid it towards the solar power project. So Togo country per se becomes important. It's in West Africa and it's a member of International Solar Alliance. So it is a member of International Solar Alliance is important, and it's in West Africa. It's right here. It's a Western Africa. It's Nigeria here, and Togo is between Ghana and the Benin. Towards the right side, there is a Benin. Towards the left, it's Ghana, and further, yeah, Burkina Faso towards the northern side. So look at the map and this is it. Further, 12th National Conference on Safety Mines inaugurated. So this is a data that we can quote in an answer, that mining sector gives employment to almost 10 lakh people and contribute around 2.6% to the GDP of the nation. So 10 lakh people it employs and contribute about 2.6% of the GDP to the nation. Further, National Conference was first started in the year 1958. So this was the 12th conference, but it's not something that has come up recently, right? In fact, it was started in the year 1958 following a disaster in this eastern India, and subsequently we were having 10 more disasters. So year of start is important. 1958 was the 12th, and this data per se is something that can be used in answer. That's it. Further, this is important. Section 17A of Prevention of Corruption Act is what? Section 70A of Prevention of Corruption Act requires prior permission before initiating investigation against a public servant. So this section provides a safeguard to public servant in provides a safety to the public servant against any sort of harassment. So Section 17A of Prevention of Corruption Act, this can be used in our answer writing as well. Further, this is important. Cabinet approves the Medical Termination of Pregnancy Amendment Bill 2020. So amendment bill is it is. So amendment to what? Amendment to a 1971 Act, and its salient features are important. Number one, it is saying that it is proposing requirement for opinion of one provider for termination of pregnancy up to 20 weeks of gestation. So if pregnancy is of 20 weeks only, then opinion of one medical practitioner would suffice in order to get it terminated. But if it's of 20 to 24 weeks, then one ought to be having opinion of two medical professionals, and that's it. Further, enhancing the upper gestation limit from 20 to 24 weeks for special categories of women. Please keep this in mind. Like everybody in Hindu newspaper, the articles were all over there in the year 2019, wherein the suggestion by the NGOs, by the women organization, was this, that one should be having the amendment act wherein the upper limit to be removed, and it is to be taken up by 24 weeks for all sort of women. But here we are not talking about all sort of women, we're talking about special categories of women. So if one is to go for the termination of the pregnancy when fetus is from 20 to 24 weeks, then it would be allowed if only you're falling under the special category, and rules gonna be deciding who the special category women are. For example, it could be a vulnerable women, including survivor of rape, victims of incest, and other vulnerable women, for example, differently able women, etc. So it's not a comprehensive provision. It's not like up to 20, anybody can go for the termination of pregnancy, provided one is having the opinion of the two medical professional or one medical professional. No, here only the special categories of women are allowed. Further, upper gestation limit not to apply in case of substantial fetal abnormalities diagnosed by medical board. So here, if definitely this was the bone of contention, because right now, as per 1971 act, no matter what, even if fetus is going for any sort of congenital abnormalities, anything, but one was not having the option to go for the termination of the pregnancy. But as per this very amended provision now, if there is substantial significant fetal abnormalities, then there is no need to adhere to the 24 weeks upper limit. One can go for it, provided it's being diagnosed by the medical board. The composition, function, and the other details of medical board to be presented subsequently in the rules under the act. So this is important. Rules are still to be formulated, it's still to be notified, and we will be needing to wait for it. Name and other particulars of women whose pregnancy has been terminated shall not be revealed, should not be enclosed, disclosed, except to a person authorized any law for the time being in force. This is either way obvious. The anonymity, the privacy has to be maintained. So the whereabouts or the name and other particular women would not be disclosed one who has undergone the termination. Further, this is the last PIB is talking about this, that Chief Election Commissioner Shri Sunil Arora assumes chairmanship of the Forum of the Election Management Bodies of South Asia for 2020, FEMBOSA, and this is a very big name, we can just call it FEMBOSA, the Forum of the Election Management Bodies of South Asia for 2020. Who is its chairman? Our Chief Election Commissioner, India's Chief Election Commissioner, Shri Sunil Arora. So information about FEMBOSA becomes important. So basically, it was established in the year 2012 at the third conference of heads of election management bodies of SAARC countries. So one thing got clear from here, that all SAARC countries are its member. So if a statement is with regard to this very thing, that all South Asian nation except Pakistan its member, we would be tempted to think as if it's right, but then it's not. All SAARC countries are its member, even the Pakistan. When was it established? Near 2012. Annual FEMBOSA meeting is held by rotation among the members, and the 9th meeting was held in Dhaka, and then 10th was held here in India. Further, few more things are there with regard to this very thing. FEMBOSA we are done with. Now let's just go to the other things. Here it is saying that Election Commission of India has established the India International Institute of Democracy and Election Management in June 2011. So if we are to talk about what all are the steps that Election Commission of India is taking to strengthen the democracy, then this is something that we can write, that Election Commission of India has established the India International Institute of Democracy and Election Management. That's it. Maybe, I mean, we really don't need to write the year per se, but the name would suffice. Further, here in the 10th FEMBOSA meeting, a new Delhi resolution was unanimously adopted. Since it's a meeting of the election commissioners, so what it could possibly be having? The resolution would possibly be having the resolutions about not to use the money power, to strengthen the democratic process of elections, to strengthen or what, to curb the money power, muscle power, to provide the greater participation of all the sections of society in the election process. So any good thing that you can think of would be a part of this resolution. So this is it. Further, there was a talk about a lot of things here. Let's just cover them now. So Voice International, this is what? Voice International is ECI's magazine. Election Commission of India is also providing a magazine. It was its 10th issue, and which carries articles on the theme of innovative methods of voter registration. Alright. Further, this PIB talked about three international organizations: AVAB, International Foundation of Electoral Systems, and International IDEA. So let's cover them now. AVAB. What is AVAB? AVAB means Association of World Election Bodies. So when was it established? In 2013. As the name suggests, it is the Association of World Election Bodies. It means all the election management bodies would be its part, and it comprises of the 115 election management bodies, and India indeed is its part. And rather, in fact, India's the chairman of this very body is the Election Commission of India, that is Sunil Arora. Further, when was it established? We have already studied 2013, where South Korea, 115 EMBs are its member, and it is doing what? It is quite obvious that it is trying to promote the democracy. Its slogan is democracy to grow for all worldwide. That's it. Further, second was about the International Foundation of Electoral Systems. So what is it? It is a non-profit organization. So unlike here, AWB, wherein the official election management bodies of a nation are its member, here it's a non-profit organization, and its members are not the official representatives but other people. So this organization was founded in 1987. It is based in USA, Arlington. Further, it helps develop and provide assistance support for elections in new and emerging democracy. When was it established is important. 1987. How much countries are getting assistance from this very thing is 145, and it has got program in over 20 countries. So that's it. Even, I mean, a tricky question can be asked. We have just gone through it, and there is nothing to be understood here. We just have to memorize all these details. But the name itself is giving all sort of things. International Foundation for Electoral System. Here it's Association of World Election Bodies. Further, last one is this IDEA or IDEA. This is basically what a very lengthy full form it has. The Declaration of Principles for International Election Observation and the Code of Conduct for International Election Observers establish the basis for credible international election observation. So IDEA is basically, it's just a document. And when was it published? It was published in 2005. So basically it is providing the assistance to strengthen the democracy, and it was endorsed by 55 intergovernmental international organizations, and its international IDEA is governed by its council of member states. So basically anybody can be its member. Organization is governed by a law, a statute, and which entered in force in 2008. Membership is open to governments. What governments? The governments which demonstrate by example in their own state their commitment to the rule of law, human rights, basic principles of democratic and pluralism, and strengthening democracy. And this is what the criteria in order to get its membership is. Further, one more point is there, and that is this here. we work with local communities. So the idea, it works with local communities, democracy practitioners and partners organizations all over the world. We have a global reach with our headquarters located in Stockholm and office in 18 countries. So IDEA's headquarters is in Stockholm and it works with local communities, democracy practitioners and partners, not just with the government but with everybody, local communities as well. So we are done with this thing as well. Here. So we're done with the PIBs till 31st of January 2020. So thank you so much for watching and goodbye.